One of the profound questions Jesus asked is, what good is it for a person to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Bob Buford, in his book Halftime, tells about achieving great success in business by the time he was in his early 40s. But he wondered, in spite of all his success, if he had really achieved significance. And so he thought about how he wanted to spend the second half of his life. In the time of his thinking and greatest need, God led him to an atheist. Mike Cammie is a strategic planning consultant for the American Management Association. He worked at IBM through their growth years, and then Xerox hired him away to do the same thing, strategic planning for them, for a seven-figure bonus. He doesn't believe in God, but Buford says, there's no doubt that God used him to speak to me. So Buford was trying to follow Cammie's directions and write the key word in the box. He says, tell me what the mainspring is in your life. What's the most important thing in your life? And Buford was telling him, well, I don't know. I'd like to shift some of my energies away from business into some sort of service. I don't know what it would look like. But I really want to pursue some different endeavors. And Cammie said to him, well, until you can tell me what's in the box, I can't really help you. But if you can tell me what's in the box, I can tell you the strategic planning implications for your life. He says, I've been listening to you for 2 hours, and it sounds to me like it's either money or Jesus Christ. You got to tell me which it is before we can move forward. Buford said, nobody had ever spoken so directly to me with such a significant question before. And in a few minutes, what seemed like an hour, he finally said, well, if it's money or Jesus Christ, I would have to say it's Jesus Christ. Some of you may find yourself in a similar place. You've reached a fork in the road. You must decide which way to go. The decision will make a huge difference in how the rest of your life plays out. Will you center your life on God or on money? Will you focus on gaining the world, yet forfeit your soul? Or will you give your life to Christ and make Him first? This is the fourth in a series of messages called Profound Questions Jesus Asked. We've reached the center point in the Gospel of Mark. The disciples have walked with Jesus for 2 years. They've seen Him heal people, cast demons out of people. They've heard Him teach. Now He's led them to the question, who do you say that I am? And Peter answers, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. This is the midpoint of Mark's account of the life of Christ, but it's not the climactic center of his gospel. The heart of the gospel comes in the next paragraph, as Jesus gives three announcements that he's going to face rejection and death. He accepts the disciples' declaration that he's the Son of God, that he's the Messiah, but now he's going to tell them what kind of Messiah he's going to be. He's going to be a suffering Messiah. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man is Jesus' favorite designation for himself. He uses it 84 times. Seldom does he use the designation Son of God, which leads some people to say Jesus didn't see himself as God, he saw himself as human, man. But that's not the case. Jesus uses the term Son of Man to refer to himself from Daniel 7, which is clearly a claim to be God. So he says, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law. And he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this. He speaks plainly. He's not speaking in a parable. This is the turning point in the Gospel of Mark. From this point forward, Jesus will talk 13 times about suffering. Everything in the Gospel from this point forward is pointing to Jesus dying on the cross. Now, Peter has a difficult time accepting this. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Peter's kind enough to take Jesus off to the side. He doesn't want to humiliate him publicly. He says, Jesus, no, you're not going to die. You're not going to suffer. I'll protect you. We learn later that Peter carries a sword. He cut off the ear of the chief priest's servant. He says, Jesus, don't worry. I got a sword. I'll protect you. You're not going to die. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. Get behind me, Satan. Those are strong words. He said, you do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men. It's interesting that the harshest words Jesus speaks are not for the money changers or the Pharisees or Herod or Pilate or Judas, but for his best friend Peter. He gives Peter a body blow. As we've reached the climactic center of Mark, God may have led you to a point where you need to make a decision. Are you going to gain the world, yet forfeit your soul? Or are you going to turn your life over to Christ and follow him? Before you do, I want you to understand what being a follower in Christ entails. Do you really want to be a Christian? Do you really want to make Christ first in your life? There will be a cost. Are you willing to pay the price? Jesus suffered, and he says those who follow him will suffer as well. You do not want to give your life to Christ thinking it's going to result in continuous blessings and everything's going to be great. What does it entail? Jesus says to be a Christian, you must do three things. First, you must deny yourself. Then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. There are the three things. Deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow him. Peter had his thoughts about what a Messiah would do, what a Messiah would be like. He pictured that Jesus would drive the Romans out of Palestine. He would deliver the Jews from the Romans. And then he would set up his kingdom and his disciples would be his high command. But Peter had it all wrong. He had his own idea of what the Messiah would do. But he needed to deny himself and his thinking and submit to Jesus' teaching about who the Messiah was. Denying ourselves does not mean we hate ourselves. We don't deny our value. It means denying that we have the right way of thinking about what life's all about, that we're self-sufficient, that we can run our lives the best way. It means denying our pride and admitting that Jesus can lead our lives and run our lives better than we can and die to ourselves. A few years ago, Jory and I were in Michigan, where Jory grew up. Jory had just spoken to the women's Bible study, and I had preached in the church we attend when we're back there. And this lady came up to us. Remember this? She said, you two have died. Now, I know I don't tan very well, but I didn't think I looked that pale. It made me want to go back and look in the house in a mirror and see how bad I looked. Now, we understood she was referring to the Apostle Paul says in Galatians 6:20, I have been crucified with Christ, and therefore I have died, and Christ lives in me. She was giving us a compliment, saying, you two have died to yourselves, and you're letting Christ live through you. Second, to be a Christian, you must take up your cross. What does Jesus mean when he says we need to take up our cross? The disciples were undoubtedly shocked when Jesus said this. For Jews, dying on a cross was a terrible thing. The Romans had instituted this as a form of execution. It was terrible. Jewish law reserved a curse for anyone who hanged on a tree, died on a cross. You must not leave his body on the tree overnight. Be sure to bury him that same day, because anyone who is hung on a tree is under God's curse. You must not desecrate the land of the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance. Jews were familiar with the dreadful sight of somebody carrying a cross beam of a cross up a hill to be crucified. The image of a cross was to mean to bear your burden. It means to persevere in the face of opposition and suffering and even death. Taking up a cross is faithful service to Christ. It means to be 100% committed to him. In the book I Am In describes the existence of Muslims who have converted to Christianity and how they are treated in the Middle East. They face a lot of persecution. Cairo has a lot of smog. It hangs over the city, and it's made more pungent by cigarette smoke and vehicle exhaust. There are hawkers on the street looking for tourists who have come to see the tombs and the pyramids and ornate mosques. But Nasir and Hoda are not tourists. They are walking to a rundown apartment building in search of a stable place to live. As they walk, they pass by some men who one speaks a jeer at Hoda, "Where's your headdress?" Muslim women in the Middle East wear headdresses, but Christian women do not. They arrived, and the landlady welcomes them, and she looks at Hoda suspiciously and explains the rental agreement and the price, and she asks them questions about their rental history and income, and so Nasir says, can we have it, the apartment? And she looks again at Hoda and looks away quickly. She looks reluctant, but finally says, you can have it if you want it. Oh, thank you, they say. They've been kicked out of apartments 12 times when people learn that they're Christians. But they've made a decision that they're going to be honest when somebody asks, are you Muslim? They used to be Muslim, but no longer. But their relief is short-lived. The landlady's husband comes out and says, well, you told them, didn't you, that the apartment's already been promised to somebody else? She said, no, I told them they could have it. Nasir says, we have an agreement. The man says, You have nothing. You have nothing but disrespect for Islam. Leave. Get out of here. The iron furnace in Egypt and countries all around the Middle East have gotten worse in recent years. Muslim extremists have worked their way into the government. So now Sharia law, Islamic law, is the law of the land in Egypt. Coptic Orthodox Christians that embraced Christ in the first century are persecuted and seeing it increase. But the people that have it the worst are Muslims who have converted to Christianity, like Nasir and Hoda. Hoda became a Christian when she was a young girl. When her parents learned that, they locked her in her bedroom. Not for a day, not for a week, but for 2 years. After 2 years, they would let her out for short periods of time. But basically, the rest of the time, they treated her like a prisoner. Hoda's cousin is a Christ follower, and he told his friend Nasir about her persecution, being kept in her bedroom. And Nasir was impressed with her faith, that she would stand for Christ in face of that kind of treatment. And so for 2 years, he thought about her, and he prayed for her, and he saved up his money. He decided he was going to rescue her. When 2 years were done, he decided it was time to take action. So with her permission, he asked her parents for her hand in marriage. They didn't know much about him. They knew that he was tall, dark-haired, and handsome. They assumed he was Muslim, but they never asked. They decided this was the best way to take care of their infidel daughter, and so they granted her in marriage. Happy ever after is not a good way to describe a Christian couple in Cairo. But they were married, they fell in love, and they determined to share Christ with their Muslim friends there. But it hasn't been easy. After being evicted the 12th time from an apartment, when people found out they were Christians and they moved again, their furniture fell apart from so many moves. And so there they were, no furniture. They had no food. It turned cold. They slept on the floor. But they were determined that God wanted them to stay in Cairo to minister for Christ. Nasir is an evangelist who teaches other people how to share Christ. And Hoda has a ministry for women who have been evicted from their homes once they became Christians. They were delighted when they had their baby boy, but that made finding a good place to live all the more important. And now that he's in school, at school he's taught that Christians are infidels and Christ is to be cursed. So when he comes home, they have to talk about it and what they believe and what's the truth. To take up your cross is to be willing to make a sacrifice like Nasir and Hoda have done. The cross stands forever as a symbol of circumstances and events in our lives that expose us, reveal our basic evil, and show our innate need for Christ. A cross is anything, an illness, an injury, a habit we can't seem to break, a business failure, a broken marriage, a problem in a relationship that brings us to the place where we realize our total need for Christ's grace. The cross reduces our trust in ourselves to nothing. We should not be so anxious to win people to Jesus that we overlook texts like this that say you have to take up your cross. Third, to be a Christian, you must follow Christ. You deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow Christ. It means to live under Christ's authority and do what he commands. Jesus says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. Discipleship means observing all that Christ commands us. Jesus asks, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I say? In what sense can we be followers of Christ if we don't do what Christ says? Is it not remarkable that it takes us so long to understand that if disobedience is the name of the game before we follow Jesus, then obedience is the name of the game after we follow Jesus? A disciple does what Jesus tells him to do. Now, we will have slip-ups. We will make mistakes. There'll be times when we don't follow Christ very well. But God's plan is for people to learn about Jesus from imperfect people like you and me, even though we blow it. Now, you may wonder, why be a Christian? If to be a Christian, you have to deny yourself, you have to take up your cross, and you have to follow Jesus, is it worth it? Is the reward worth the sacrifice? Jesus answers this concern. Mark 8:35, whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. Jesus assures us that any sacrifice we make for him will be more than rewarded. You'll save your life. Jesus says, loosen the grip on your life. You know, we're taught in this world that we have to clutch on to everything. No one else will take care of you. You have to take care of yourself. But Jesus says, no, no. You give up taking care of yourself and you turn controls over to me. I can lead your life better than you can. Trust me. And you'll experience real life. Notice Jesus appeals to our desires. He says, ask, seek, and knock, and it'll be open to you. We all have desires to have life, real life, to have long life, to experience deep relationships. He says, if you give up control of your life and turn it over to me, you'll have real life. You'll save your life. When we meet Christ and realize that he's the one that can give us the best life, the fullest life, then we're excited and we want nothing more than to know him better. Howard Hendricks used to teach at Dallas Seminary, and he had the privilege of leading a man to Christ. He says, do you have a Bible? He says, no. Here, take this one. It's just a New Testament. Read it. So the guy came back in a week. He says, I read it. Howard says, no, I meant read the whole thing. He says, I did, including the palms in the back. So Howard gave him a full Bible with the Old Testament. He says, read this. Guy came back a week later. He says, I read it. I mean, we probably have elders in the church who haven't read the whole Bible. This guy read it in 2 weeks. And he and Howard came out of his office and they stood in front of Howard's assistant, and there were five board members from Dallas Seminary waiting to meet with Howard. And this guy, as he turns to leave, he turns to Howard and he says, Howard, this stuff is so damn exciting. Howard's going, when we're excited about Christ, we're bold in following him. We're not ashamed of letting people know we follow him. Jesus says, if anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels. If we're ashamed of him, he'll be ashamed of us. In high school, I learned how to pray before lunch without letting anybody know. I prayed with my eyes open. Nobody had a clue. Or better yet, I would lean over and tie my shoes and pray while I was doing that. Nobody knew what I was doing. Jesus says, if you're ashamed to pray in front of other people, let people know you follow me, then I'll be ashamed of you. On the other hand, if you stand bold for me and let people know you follow me, you put yourself in a position where someday you'll stand before me and hear me say, well done, good and faithful servant. To hear those words will make any sacrifice we make in this world worth it all. Jesus asks, what good is it for a man to gain the whole world yet forfeit his soul? What can a person give in exchange for their soul? This is our profound question today. It's a rhetorical question. We all know it's foolish to gain the world yet forfeit our soul. The Greek word for soul refers to the inner life, the inner person, our deepest thoughts, our will, and our emotions. Jesus says, what good is it to gain the whole world, yet cut yourself off from your real self, your real desires, your feelings? But if you want to have real life, all that you really want to experience, then give your life to me. On the one hand, Jesus says life of discipleship means suffering and sacrifice. On the other hand, he says it's richly rewarded. The person with an eye for business will see that Christian life is the best deal. If you try to save your life and ignore Christ, you will lose it. You'll have everything you want, but you won't want everything you have. You'll find the life that you're trying to grasp slips through your fingers. But if you give up running your life and turn it over to Christ, he will give you real life. You'll save your life. I know a man who built a great company. He made crazy money. But he said, I haven't done much with my marriage, kids, or God. So his life looked like this. Work predominated his life, and he just had a small slice for marriage and faith and children and hobbies and friends. Bicyclists often use spy rearview mirror sunglasses so they can see behind them. It's important for us to look behind us to see what we're leaving behind. When you look behind yourself, what do you see as your legacy? Do you like the legacy you see? The good news is that legacies can change in an instant. The thief on the cross, dying next to Jesus, said, I believe in you, Jesus. And Jesus said, you'll be with me today in heaven. His last decision made up for all his mistakes. You can change your life in an instant. I'll give you an opportunity to make that change in a moment. Chuck Colson changed from the ruthless hatchet man in the Nixon administration to a follower of Christ with 50,000 people volunteering in prisons around the world. You can change the direction of your life in an instant. Gaining the world will never satisfy, but following Christ will. We all have a choice to make. Will we gain the world and forfeit our souls? Or will we lose our lives for Christ's sake and save our lives? Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we thank you for your words, your teaching, that if we want to save ourselves, we have to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow you. I think for every one of us here today, we have that question to consider. Will we gain the whole world and make that our pursuit and forfeit our soul? Or will we give up ourselves and turn our lives over to Christ and make him first in our lives? If you have never committed your life to Christ, you can do that right now. I'm going to give you a minute just to pray silently, and you can say, Jesus, I've heard enough. I believe in you. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sins, and I want you in my life. I want to turn my life over to you and make you first. Maybe you feel like you've prayed something like that in the past, but you could do that again. You're still in this battle of who's first, money, things, your life, or is it Jesus Christ? And you could turn it all over to Christ today and say, I want to put you first again. So I want to give you all a minute just to pray. You pray. Lord Jesus, this is an important moment for all of us as we look at our lives and look at what kind of legacy we're leaving and maybe see that, you know what, we have to put you first. And so many of us have done that today. And put you first in our lives. Help us to do that now and follow you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.